Since white has not played a3 to provoke this exchange, notice white's bishop may enjoy the a3 to f8 diagonal in the future. This is a good moment for black to castle. White enjoys the bishop pair, but black's light squared blockade in the center can prove quite annoying. White should prepare to evict the e4 knight with a move such as knight e1, or the more common knight d2, adding pressure against the knight and preparing f3. Since white's knight has vacated the f3 square, this allows black to play the active response queen h4, supporting the knight and building tension against white's kingside. White should continue with the plan of f3, when black can either simplify the position with knight takes d2, or keep the game complicated with knight g5. But a bad idea for white is to try and punish this adventurous queen move with g3, attacking the queen, but weakening the light squares around white's king. Instead of reacting to the attack against the queen, black can exploit these weak light squares with knight g5. White can still stay afloat with f3, a move which should have been played instead of g3. But if white accepts the queen with g takes h4, black's light squared strategy triumphs with knight h3. Checkmate. In addition to the straightforward bishop d3, white has another interesting idea with knight e2, supporting the pin knight, so if black captures the knight, white can play knight takes c3, maintaining a healthy pawn structure. One drawback to this move is it blocks the light squared bishop, so the c4 pawn is loose. Black can immediately add pressure against this pawn with bishop a6. White sometimes responds with knight g3, revealing the light squared bishop's defense of the c4 pawn. But a more popular option is a3. Black may decide to preserve the dark squared bishop with bishop e7. Definitely an option worth exploring. But another reasonable plan is to play bishop takes c3 check, surrendering the bishop pair after knight takes c3. White has avoided doubling the c-pawns, but black is ready to strike in the center with d5, adding more pressure against the c4 pawn. White can reinforce this pawn with b3, when black typically takes the chance to castle the king to safety. A flexible choice for white is bishop e2. Without a knight on f3, and with black's bishop on a6, it isn't out of the question to consider a future bishop f3, adding pressure down the long light squared diagonal. Continuing to add pressure against white's center is a reasonable plan, so black may consider playing knight c6. Preparing knight a5, adding more pressure against the c4 pawn. One interesting idea for white is to play a4, awakening the dark squared bishop, and also supporting the b5 square. The point is that after knight a5, adding more pressure against c4, white can develop the dark squared bishop with bishop a3, attacking black's rook on f8. After rook e8, white can simply ignore the tension against the c4 pawn and castle the king. Black should definitely consider reinforcing the center with c6, also discouraging future knight b5 ideas. But if black plays the materialistic d takes c4, white can play b4, attacking the knight and threatening b5. So black's knight is forced to lunge into enemy territory with knight b3. In response to knight b3, the rook can calmly step to the side with rook b1. White is ready to play b5, preparing to capture the pawn with bishop takes c4 and enjoy a strong position. In response to the nimzo, instead of blocking the dark squared bishop with e3, a natural looking but not especially popular move for white is bishop g5. If black can pin white with bishop b4, why can't white return the favor with bishop g5? Activating the bishop before playing e3. There is certainly nothing wrong with this move, but with proper play, it isn't particularly challenging to black. Black can immediately question the bishop with h6. And unless white wants to surrender the bishop pair and help black develop with bishop takes f6, then the common response is bishop h4, maintaining the tension against black's knight, but now this bishop is committed to the king side. This may prove to be an important feature after black strikes in the center with a thematic c5. If white supports the center with e3, black is able to generate counterplay on the queen side with c takes d4, e takes d4, softening white's center, followed by the active queen a5. The absence of white's dark squared bishop on the queen side may be felt, as this bishop does not have the option to unpin the knight with bishop d2. If white tries to defend the knight while also keeping an eye on the d4 pawn with queen d3, black has the instructive resource, knight e4. taking advantage of the pinned knight, as queen takes e4 allows the unpleasant bishop takes c3 check. Black is ready to reinforce the knight with d5 when black enjoys a comfortable position. Instead of e3, white can decide to grab space with d5. White removes the tension from d4, but now creates tension between the d5 and e6 pawns. This allows black the option to consider the dynamic pawn sacrifice b5, or play a more calm, strategically minded game with bishop takes c3 check, doubling white's c-pawns after b takes c3. When black can commit to a dark-squared central pawn structure with d6, preparing e5, so black's central pawn structure will restrict white's dark-squared bishop. This typically leads to close games with plenty of positional maneuvering, in which black's solid position has not been especially challenged from the early development of white's dark-squared bishop. From amateur to grandmaster, the Nimzo Indian is one of black's most popular defenses against d4. Instead of directly occupying the center with pawns, black controls the position with piece play, most notably the pin against white's knight on c3. Black is often willing to surrender the bishop pair, either to compromise white's pawn structure or gain time for comfortable development. White is willing to enter these lines thanks to the dynamic potential of the bishop pair, overall active piece play, and the rich pawn play available to fight for central dominance. If you enjoy positionally complex play, where ideas are generally more important than concrete variations, then you may very well find a home on either side of this fascinating opening.